feel is real. I could cry, I could smile, I might lay back for a while. Tell me what would I do if I could feel?
Pretty much a partner with my husband in the store, Fit for Visuals. My husband worked in the store in New York. I don't know if anybody remembers when it was on Spring Street. Does anybody know Union here?
Yes.
So my husband, who I introduced him to, James Devia and Marianne Fusco, who Marianne actually was the owner of Union before we took it over, almost 10 years ago. But my husband ran it like it was his store from the beginning. He worked in the store for like 10 years. And he was the owners of Union LA, which is different than the owners of Union in New York, or the former owners of Union in New York, offered him the store when he decided, offered to sell him the store when he decided to do other things. That owner now owns Undefeated, Supreme LA, and so yeah, it's a really interesting story. It's all about like family, friends looking out, which would never happen today. Unfortunately, we're trying to, I think, I can't speak for everyone, but I know a lot of us have been in this for a long time and we've all kind of operated the way we've been taught, which is just like tons of respect and love and, you know, community. And that's why I'm still in this world. I'm old now.
Still got it going on.
But I'm not ashamed of that because I think a lot of people think it happens overnight, and it never happens overnight. I've been in this business for years and years and years and years, for at least 20 years. And before, in the music industry, it takes a long time. And the people that, when it happens for them fast, they normally burn out fast. So definitely, like, you know, you just want to get to know your craft if you're into it, hone it, love it, know everything about it, and don't give up. Like, if you're really passionate about it, it will happen. It won't happen overnight, but it will happen if you keep going. So, that's
Tremaine.
How you guys doing? My name is Tremaine Emery. One half of No Vacant CN. Also got another brand, Dylan Tears BF, that I do with my brother, Brendan Fowler. I'm also worked with a lot of artists in the last several years. So some people call it creative direction, art direction. I like the word like creative gardener. So just help ideas, musicians particularly, or brands, help their ideas grow. And yeah, like I'm an idea guy. Yeah, and that's what I do.
Cool. Mel?
Hi, my name is Melody Asani. I have a brand, and I started off making shoes 10 years ago. Shoes eventually evolved into jewelry and accessories, and now it's a full, I do apparel, shoes, the whole nine. And yeah, that's what I do.
Mr. Greg?
My name is John, and I work with the Culinary Collective based in the Bronx. Ghetto Gastro, and I am the dishwasher of said collective, right there, fucking out of the intersection of food, politics, art.
Cool. So, I mean, I feel like the reason why most of y'all showed up is because, you know, you want to know what the recipe is, right? Everyone here is working on their own hustle, trying to figure it out. And like, with that said, it didn't happen overnight. You know, like for me, for example, it's been a slow grind. You know what I mean? And over the years, I've learned that it's really more about quality over quantity, right? So I think what's really interesting, what we could give is a bit of insight. And from Mel, you know, like I've always been curious, like what made you, or what inspired you to start on the path that you're on right now?
Well, I had a passion for justice, so I went to law school and then I dropped out because I did a bunch of internships and I didn't like the day-to-day of it, where I was like, I can't wake up every day for the rest of my life and do this. So I was really confused because growing up, I grew up in a very traditional household and I felt like, or I was taught that justice could only be worked towards if you worked in something that was super obvious, like the law. And so I sort of went through a period of time where I really had to go inside myself and ask myself big questions, and I realized that I was really good with products. And my whole life I always look at products and I always think about how I can make them better or more beautiful, or I find the holes in the market of things that I wish I would have that didn't exist. So it sort of started in that way where I wanted to make women's heels because I was a sneakerhead growing up, and I had sort of graduated into heels and I wasn't really fucking with sneakers anymore. And I was like, but I want to make heels that have elements, like the same special elements that sneakers do, because sneaker designers put so much detail and effort and they have a story, whereas heels don't really do that. And so I started with women's heels and I wanted to make them comfortable. And I went through a whole process where I tried to work for companies or do different things and nothing was really panning out. So I did a bunch of research and I found some factories and I reached out to a bunch of factories. And the only ones that would get back to me were in this small city in China. So I ended up moving to China for 6 months and I figured out how to make shoes in that process, and then I came back with my first collection. And then after I did that, I realized that just by virtue of me sharing my story of how I got to that place, the sort of justice element came in, because just by virtue of me doing what I do in the way that I do, it was empowering other women to want to do that same thing. And so it just all kind of ended up weaving together and sort of came together in a way that I could have never imagined just by me following my heart. Sounds so cliche. So, yeah.
Thank you, Mel. Tremaine, I'd like to ask you the same question.
Please repeat the question.
Man, that's not fair. I want to know what was the turning point in your trajectory, or at what point in your life that you were like, you know what, I got to go for it. You know, where it went? Because a lot of people don't know, like, what, you know, like me, Tremaine, and Beth have known each other for damn near 20 plus years at this point. So like when Tremaine and I met, we were literally both folding t-shirts in retail shops. I was working at Stussy and Tremaine was working at Marc Jacobs. So like, once again, to kind of dispel this myth like that this shit happened overnight for us, it was like, we've literally been in the grind for 20 years. You know what I mean? So like, I've been to like Tremaine's first DJ gig. Tremaine's been to like one of my first art shows. Like, he collected my first t-shirt, Absurd, when I made it back in 2001 when I worked at Stussy. So like, a lot of that narrative hasn't been told, you know. So I'm always down to open up the books, because I, you know, for me, I don't gain anything by like holding any secrets, you know. Like for me, like real wealth is like giving it away. I don't mean to go off on a tangent, sorry. But like, Tremaine, the question was like, you know, at what point, what inspired you to be like, you know what, fuck it, I want to go for it.
When my mom died. Yo, my bad, yo. It's just like New York's like a town with a haunted house. So yeah, basically my mom passed away like 3 or 4 years. So like the last conversation we had on the phone was crazy. My mom called me. I called her on her birthday, December 12th. And I haven't seen her in a year. I've just been on the grind, started working with Frank Ocean. He hit me up off the blue, and I was doing creative consulting for him. I just signed a consultancy contract with Stussy, my man Flacco. He was living in London as well. So was in the around for that A La album. Me and my man Asa really got it going. So the last conversation I had with my mom, she was like, said to me, do you think there's anything you can do by going back to school that could help your career at Marc Jacobs? And I chuckled on the phone and I said, Mom, I think I've figured some things out. And I told her I'm working with this guy, Frank Ocean, this guy, Flacco, doing all this stuff with Stussy. I'm doing all this stuff with my best friend, Eastside. You gotta meet him. Doing the stuff with this dude, Virgil, Benji B, just kind of like all the kind of murderous row of people that I work with. I have worked with and worked with at this point. And, you know, she just said, she didn't ask me how much anybody was paying me. She didn't ask me, like, you know, anything. Only thing she said is, I'm happy you finally figured out to work in all the stuff you've always been interested in. Because I was a union rat. Like, I was in union every day. Like, every day. Lunch break, after work, hang out at union, you know what I mean? Get thrown free tea, go back to Queens, come back on the railroad, got the tea on, we out all night. So, I really been around and tuned into all this stuff, like, since I was a kid. So, yeah, the turning point for me, so the turning point was my mom dying, and the inception, so, because my mom, so my dad's right there, he's an Emmy Award winning TV news cameraman. I think he's got about 4 Emmys. He's been nominated, maybe almost 10 times. You know, so the reason he was able to do that, besides his own talent, was he had my mom. My mom was the manager. She ran the whole house and ran everything. She's Phil Jackson, Warren Buffett, all that. And just a great person. So for me, my mom was a straight A student. She sacrificed everything so she could raise her kids and support her husband, as women unfortunately did at that time. And now, like, fortunately, things are very different for women and they're gonna keep getting better. But my mom never got a chance to do all the things she could do outside of being a wife or a mom. So my whole thing is, like, I make my life her afterlife. So that's, like, my motivation. My mom and my little brother.
Thank you for that. That's pretty much it. Thank you for being so honest with us, Tremaine. You know, I know that takes a lot. That's not easy, you know. It's really easy to walk around and act like shit is all, like, okay and put on a face. So, you know, what you're doing is really brave, and I appreciate that. I'm pretty sure there's a lot of people that I can identify with you right now, so. I just want to commend you and say thank you. I love you as a brother, and you know that already.
Yeah, I love you too, Pete.
John, you ain't off the hook. I know you're a man of mystery. I follow you on Instagram. You everywhere, London, Tokyo, Berlin, Damien Hirst, this, then of that, that, then of this. But, like, where did it all begin, John? That's what I want to know. Because
July 14th, 2006.
Can we get John's mic up, please?
Louder. So, like, July 14th, 2006, I got caught up. I caught a case on an intent to sell and distribute, and I had a lot of just drugs on me. And I was facing, long story short, I was facing 10 to life. But the week before that, I went to the Funk Master Flex car show, and it was like people making t-shirts, and there was this thing called streetwear. But I was looking at the characters that were involved, and I'm like, I'm really in these streets. I don't really see anybody that I feel is representing the streets. So when I caught the case, I bailed out immediately, and I said, I'm gonna make t-shirts. And Dunion actually was, like, one of the first shops to carry my t-shirts, Marianne.
All these about the union.
Yeah. So, and then, like, doing fashion and from t-shirts to denim, having minor successes, like, pre-Instagram, so. You kind of needed stores in those days. It was hard to go direct to consumer. So I just burned through all my money from the streets. And I was like, all right, now I'm broke. What is life about? You know, because for most of my life, it was about chasing a bag, and I didn't understand what I really cared about. So I had to think about what I would do for free, and it kind of all led back to food. But food was something I thought I would have to make $1 billion first. And then we visited my homie Leslie somewhere in here. Yeah. So we grew up on the same block, and we were always plotting, like, yo, we're going to do something with this food thing. And I woke up from a nap with the name Ghetto Gastro, and I'm like, you just really have to create the art that you want to see in the world. And I felt like it was a gap. When I would go out to different restaurants, I never saw people that looked like me in them. And I'm like, all right, yo, let's just kind of take the training that, like, in my man Mac, who's like the best pastry chef in the world, worked at Roma and all that. And so I'm like, yo, let's just kind of distill what it means to grow up in the Bronx and bring that to the world through cuisine. That was like a long
answer. No, not at all. You keep going, by the way.
Yeah.
I ain't gonna cut you off.
That's it.
That's your hot 16 right there?
That was like a hot 32.
All right. Oh, man. By the way, I kind of hate doing these things, but I also love them at the same time. So, Mel, what I'm curious to know is, I'm pretty sure that not every door was open to you when you first started, you know?
And are you talking to me?
Yeah. I mean, you're the only Mel up here. So.
Kind of mumbling a little bit.
Mel, I can only assume that your journey and your path has not been so smooth, because mine hasn't. But I can't identify with being a woman. And the challenges that it comes with, because the truth is that, you know, streetwear is a very male-dominated industry. So, you know, what I would like to know is just kind of like, what have been some of the challenges that you faced, right? And that basically have not broken you, because you're here and you're standing here, you know, and for a lot of people that don't know, Mel not only owns one, but two stores. She has a store on Fairfax in Los Angeles, and she has a store on Kenmare here in New York. So I don't even have a store. So, you know, for me, like, I commend you for excelling in business the way you have. So I'm curious, you know, like,
is it all by yourself?
She does it for Dolo. Yeah, so, you know, what are the challenges, and basically how, you know, have you, what process do you take to overcome those hurdles?
Well, there are a lot of challenges, as there is with anything in life, but I think that the more important thing is sort of what gets me through them. And I think that for me, the idea of creating a new culture or creating a new way of looking at things or doing things is sort of what drives me and allows me to overcome those obstacles or whatever it is. So at some point, I think, from the beginning, the end goal has always been creating my own sort of world in the way that I would want to see it. So what kind of business would I create that really reflected back to me the morals and the principles that I wanted instilled in the world? So I literally just wrote down all the things that were important to me, like the equality of men and women, you know, disparaging the gap between the rich and the poor, and unity and diversity. And I started figuring out how to implement all those things into a business model. So, for example, you know, within the first like year of having employees, I realized that unity is the most important element in a group environment, and the number one destroyer of unity is gossip or backbiting. So that became like, boom, first rule in the handbook, like, gossip is immediate cause for getting fired. So if you talk shit about the customer, if you talk shit about each other, if you talk shit about Madonna, I don't give a fuck, you're getting fired. And that, having that be such a stringent rule, like, really created a different sort of culture in the back end of my business. And then, you know, like, getting rid of the extremes of wealth and poverty in the world. I took that and I was like, okay, how can we structure this within the business? So now, regardless of how much the business makes, every senior level employee only like has a salary cap. So regardless of how much the company makes, I only make X amount because that's how much I need to live. But it's never going to exceed beyond that, because it's you know, it's not really necessary. You know, it's so the wealth is going to be distributed in a different way. So that's the kind of thing that keeps me up at night. That's the kind of thing that really like makes me happy and inspires me and makes me want to, you know, it almost makes me be like, bring the obstacles, because I know that I'm creating something that's never existed before. And I think that that's where I found my passion. So outside of products and design, for me is more so the vehicle. I love doing it. I love finding holes in the market and seeing what it is. But when I work with a factory that has an issue with me being a woman or doesn't take me seriously or whatever, it's just sort of like, it's like the foam in the sea, you know? It's just sort of like, you know, it's an obstacle, but it's not going to stop me, because I think I've always kind of had my eye on something bigger.
John, correct me if I'm wrong, there's 4 or 5 members in the Ghetto Gastro Collective?
There's four partners, 4 founding members.
4 founding partners.
But it's a big team.
4 African-American founding fathers of Ghetto Gastro, correct?
Yeah.
So, you know, let me just rephrase the question, you know, just a bit. What have been some of the challenges that you guys have faced as a collective to basically literally make your seat at the table? Because I'm you know, I'll be the first one. I was type hating a little bit when I first saw it. I was like, what the fuck do they know about food, you know? So I can only imagine, you know, that multiplied by 100, what you guys have faced. So I'm just curious, you know, what have been some of the challenges and situations, and how do you guys as a collective, because I see you, you know, like as like Voltron, and you know, you're the head, you know, so like how do you lead? How do you lead the squad through those situations?
I wouldn't say I'm the head. I'm just a dishwasher. But I think anything that could be considered like a weakness. I think anything that could be considered a weakness, like, we turn into a strength. So being unapologetically Black and like doing that and wearing that on our sleeve, not being afraid to charge people a lot of bread and then distribute that bread how we see fit, you know, because we're not asking for permission. We kind of just, like, we just treating it like the streets at the end of the day. And
John's not lying. I remember, can I just interject real quick? We were in London, and then Jefferson Hack, who he runs like owns Days Magazine. We go to this really like what was it, Venus Central restaurant, something like that.
Something terrible.
And he's like, oh, you know John? And I was like, John who? Da da da. And we walk in a restaurant, and this is, you know, Jefferson Hack, runs Days, got a kid, baby, you know, Kate Moss's baby mother, blah blah blah. Amazing dude. And we walk in this really fancy restaurant, and John got his do-rag on, and I was just like, this is beautiful. Because you know, because John was being 100% himself. And that's my main thing to people. Always be 100% yourself, long as it's not hurting no one else, because you will have no regrets. You will only regret subjugating yourself. And then look back like, I subjugated myself. I wasn't really myself, and it still didn't work out. Or it worked out, but you don't feel right. That's the beautiful thing about Ghetto Gastro, is those guys are really themselves. And they're working with some of the, you know, Tom Sachs, Rick Owens, Nike, whatever brands, and they're doing it, being themselves. They're not changing the vocal tone of their voice or how they dress or nothing. They're just them, and they do really good work, and they treat people really good. So I just wanted to add on to that.
I couldn't have said it better. And I think a big thing for us is making sure that, like, we use the name Ghetto Gastro because, you know, ghetto has its connotations of being negative. But I feel like it's so much gold that we need to mine ourselves, and we don't need like validation from outside culture to be like, oh, this is worth something. And that goes in terms of the art that we create, and even just the space we occupy, like in our neighborhood. Like, it doesn't take a coffee shop from downtown or open and be like, oh, now this is worth this square footage here. Like, I think we just need to own it and understand that we are the gold and we have value.
Beth, I'd like to ask you the same question. You know, what have been some of the challenges that you faced, and you know, what processes, or you know, how have you overcome them over these years?
I'm still trying to overcome a lot of them. Yeah, I've been in this business for a long time, and it's definitely changed. I see a lot of young women who don't have a lot of the obstacles that I might have had. I mean, even, you know, down to just being true to who you are, that was very difficult to do like 10, 15 years ago as a black woman. Just to be able to wear your hair however you want. People have been trying to change me from the very beginning, and I think that's why I really gravitated to this world, because I felt like I could just be me. And that's really rare. It's a rare industry. It's rare to be able to make money and still be who you are, especially being of color and being different. So I don't know, it's, that's where, you know, kind of being able to create and have a focus. I started doing a brand, Bethy, just because I needed to, an outlet. I've been working with my husband for a long time, and I'm not very vocal. I haven't put myself out there. I have two boys. That's been very important to me. And I didn't really feel the need to come out until I saw that there weren't many women actually that worked in streetwear that were vocal. There were a lot of men that would be like, oh, she's hot. We're gonna make her the girl that should be the representative for women's streetwear. And, you know, I see women like Melody, who I met. She's like a really good friend, family. And she's also my hero, because it's really hard to navigate. But I do think community, which is another reason why I was attracted to streetwear, community makes a difference. And the thing that I haven't seen a lot of women do is support other women. And I don't think a lot of people understand how important that is. And that's why I started the Bethy Collection, because I wanted to be a woman that supports other women, young women, old women, whoever you are. I just wanted to be that brand, that, you know, that lifestyle brand, because every streetwear brand, there's kind of a lifestyle, whether it's music, you know, skateboarding, whatever it is, and mine just wants to be, you know, a woman's community. And it doesn't mean it's anti-man. It's not anti-anyone, it's just supporting other people, and it happens to be women right now. Cool. Women, yeah. Trans.
All that.
All that.
Thank you, Beth.
What I would like to point out real quick, you know, the whole objective of social studies is to not only show you guys how it can be done, the most important that the people that are involved look just like you, right? And I also want to point out that everyone that's sitting up here, we own our own businesses. So when I was your guys' age or even younger, I had no fucking idea of how to, like, I didn't even think it was feasible to own anything. You know, I wasn't taught to save money. I wasn't taught to buy property. No one told me that I could be a photographer, a creative director, art director. You know, I honestly just thought it was some white people shit. You know, and the day I told my mother I was gonna go to art school, she started crying and told me that I'd be a beggar in the street. Yeah. Look who's laughing now, Mom. Anyway, she still has no idea what the hell I do for a living. But yeah, I just want to point that out real quick. You know, the whole objective of this is to build a platform in order to create ownership. Ownership is really important. Whatever you guys do, whatever you guys are owning, like, make sure you read all the fine lines before you go into any kind of bullshit contracts. You know what I mean? Make sure you educate yourselves, and if you don't know, then ask someone that does, you know.
That's why community is important.
Exactly, to what Beth was saying about community. And then I'm just gonna segue from ownership and taking lead into originality, you know, which I feel like is something that's kind of like a hot topic for debate, you know, and I feel one unique individual that I know is Tremaine, right? And Tremaine keeps me on my toes. You know, like I dropped the fishbowl tea in the summer, and he was like, "Oh, word!" And then he dropped some Malcolm X tea. So, you know, it's like, it's a nice, friendly kind of like back and forth, and it keeps me on
with
my
the
phone.
Final, with the final, mean, you know, his last speech, but.
But, you know, Tremaine, you know, like, what I want to know from you is, you know, like, not only, like, how do you pick the projects that you decide to work on, because I know you're a very selective person, but, you know, this whole kind of process of originality and individuality, you know, how does that play into your process as a whole, as, you know, Denim Tears and Tremaine Emery and No Vacancy
in? It plays a big part, because, you know what I could liken it to? I grew up, like, me, my mom, my pop, we always watched boxing, you know what I mean? And, like, obviously there's a certain way you box, right? Cross, hook, but everyone got different styles. Tyson fought one way, Lennox Lewis fought one way, you know, and your style is developed by your who you are. Mike Tyson, he did the quick knockout thing because he had asthma. He had to knock people out. He had asthma, he couldn't do 12 rounds. You know, so the Michael, from the, what I'm, the analogy I'm creating is, my originality comes from my circumstances, the good things I have, and the things I have against me. You know, like, I remember I interviewed David Blaine once, and he said his first magic trick was learning how to hold his breath so he could keep up with the kids when he was swimming, because he had a natural gait in his legs. And so for him to keep up and not get made fun of with the kids, he had to really learn how to hold his breath. And that's how he got into magic. And that's really, if I would have been able to answer it goes to both these questions. Your originality and style goes to how you meet resistance in your life. So if you're trying to avoid resistance and conflict and you're governed by fear, you will be a chameleon of yourself and the world around you, because you're just running from things. So, well, I'll hang with these dudes, dress like them, or do like this because they get these girls and they get this money. And you're constantly, you're not like, well, I'm not really down with those dudes, so I gotta figure out how to get the girls and the money and esteem my own way. And then that's how your own style unfurls, based on how you're meeting resistance that you come across in life, because people are trying to avoid resistance. You can't. You're gonna have resistance. People are gonna die. You're gonna lose a job. Bad things are gonna happen. You're gonna have a bad day. So it's just, that's really where my aesthetic comes from, is reacting to things that come at me, instead of trying to avoid it. Kind of weird, but that's my thing.
Cool. Thank you, Tremaine. So what I would like to do at this point, one, thank you all for participating in this conversation, but most importantly, as I want to hear from everyone in this room. I'm really curious the questions that you guys got. Don't hold back. Hold back on the salt and the hate, because we will clap back at you. So I want to open it up to the floor, you know, so anyone that has a question, feel free to raise your hand.
So how you guys doing? I really think what you guys are doing is really dope. By the way, I just want to say that. My question as a creative director and a business owner is, how do you get to the point where people trust you enough to give you that opportunity to trust you to be a creative director?
That's your question?
Yeah, that's my question.
Cool. I'll take that. So, I'll tell you, when I decided to leave Supreme 2 years ago, I asked my friend Scott Galately for advice, right? So one, just in the act of asking for advice is humility, because I had to admit to myself that I didn't know shit, right? So it didn't matter that I had a 10-year career as a brand director Supreme, like, I knew that I was about to venture into a whole other section of life that I had no clue, right? So what Scott told me was, you know, the day of the cool guy just waltzing into a corporate office and saying, hey, give me $10,000 a month to give you my opinion, he's like, those days are over. What you need to do is start your own agency. And he's like, it doesn't matter that if it's just you sitting in your bedroom at home, or it's you with 100 employees and a big ass, loft studio in Chelsea. Because the minute you package yourself as an agency, those doors will open up for you. You know, so it's really about packaging and presentation, right? And, you know, straight up, like, fake it till you make it, you know? Because I'll tell you, man, I tried before to just kind of pitch myself as an individual, as Angelo Bacchi, and trying to get those checks, trying to get that bag, and it just never really came to fruition. But the minute, literally, it took $300 to go to my lawyer and create a LLC for Bacchi Creative, those doors like went wide open. Wide open, you know, and from that point on, it just really started. And then, so, you know, we're talking about, you know, 20% bullshit, and then 80% now you gotta be about it. You know, like now, like what Tremaine is talking about, like the originality, you know, like the idea. Because like that's why companies are coming to me right now, is because they want ideas. Because truth be told, like they don't know. And for the you know, and no disrespect for the people that work at those corporations, you know, like what we're doing up here is scary. It's scary, you know, like, and I always relate it to, like, you know, I call it the 50 Cent get rich or die trying moment. You know, it's like either it's gonna happen or it's not. And being prepared for either one. Because if it doesn't, it's all right. At the end of the day, like, I'll be fine. Because I came from nothing, you know, like, I literally came from, like, mayonnaise sandwiches and quarter waters and all that. You know, so like, I can go back to that. That's okay. But if it does happen, then all right, let's keep rolling the dice. And that's basically what happened here with social studies, you know, like, being able to take ownership and take the lead and take ownership of the narrative and not letting a corporation tell me, you know, what my culture is about. You know what I mean? Because I've been doing this shit for damn near, you know, like I said, over 20 years with my friends up here. And so, like, I don't know, did that help?
Yeah, it did.
Oh, can I add one thing to that question? I was just saying, I would focus less on being a creative director. And more on being a storyteller, because titles are limiting, and you know, creative director is the zeitgeist word of the moment. And I'm not knocking anyone that wants to be one or is one.
I'm not offended, Tremaine.
Yeah, but really, all of it, from Peter Saville to Picasso to Miles Davis, right? So let's say Picasso is a painter, Peter Saville is a graphic designer, Miles Davis is a played trumpet, band leader. They're all storytellers. That's it. It's all just storytelling. Just focus on that and then a lot of stuff will come. And I think the title creative director is limiting. Like when I see Angelo, I just see like an artist that has made his work commercial. You know, that's the creative director is limiting. Just focus on telling stories. Angelo's a storyteller. That's the best title. That's what humans are. We started off around a campfire, tribal society, we're telling stories, painting on walls, and we're still doing it now with a t-shirt or for a 2-hour film or a sculpture at the moment.
Thank you, Tremaine. In the Yankee t-shirt, Siobhan, what question did you have? You sure?
Yeah.
Back there with the orange beanie? Mel, can you take the lead on that, please?
Just show up to things like this and invite your friends. I think that there's really big power in people just coming together. That's how movements start. It's always from the bottom up. It's never from the top down. So just getting together, being, you know, making friends at these kinds of things, finding like-minded people, connecting with them, and just building with those people and supporting those people that you know are about it, I think is what does it. And I think oftentimes we get down on ourselves because we feel like, oh, we're just one person or we're just one thing, but we're so much bigger than that. Like this is, you know, we're entities and we're big entities. And so I think just that is, this is it. This is how you do it.
Cool. Beth, would you like to add on to that?
No, I was just gonna say, just do it. Like whatever it is you're feeling, you want to, you know, do beyond an influencer. I mean, influencer, that word is how can you really influence people, you know? And a lot of people aren't doing anything. So do something different and do it, and just do something.
Let me just add on one quick thing too, like that whole influencer thing, like that shit is a wrap. You know, like, let's be for real. You know, like, because what because once again, that's corporations telling you what influencer is. You know, if you have over 500,000 followers, suddenly you're influencer, that's bullshit. It's bullshit, you know what I'm saying? Like, you really, like what Tremaine was saying, like just individuality and creativity and really working on yourself. And then naturally all that stuff will happen and come and you become a leader. And it's really about leadership.
Yeah, and also last thing on influence is like, again, things are created to sell things in capitalist societies. So idea of a celebrity was created because we need people to look up to these people so they come to the film just because this person is in it, even if they don't enter the story that was written, and we need to sell things. 2018, people need to, corporations need to sell stuff. So this word influencer has been created, title put on it, so that to push product. That's all, it's, don't, in my opinion, don't listen to me though. Think for yourself, filter what I said, and then choose yourself. It's just a title to put, help push product. Figure out, you know, I think storytelling and whatever way you do it, you know? That's right.
Cool, thank you. The young woman in the back. Yeah, you, with the hand up. Instagram.
Can I jump on this one too?
Yeah.
Go ahead. Don't approach them, just make sure the work that you do is dope and they approach you. And then it's like you're sitting at a different, it's like the Larry David skit when him and Lin-Manuel were fighting for the high chair in the office. You know, it's like you're sitting in a different space when somebody brings something to you and then you really collaborate versus a pitch. But it's okay to pitch too, to kind of get your feet wet and see how it feels. But in my experience, it's always dope when it's mutual, because the thing that happens is people don't really like other people's ideas. They want an idea that's theirs. So you either make it feel like the idea is theirs and you're supporting them on moving it forward or something like that.
That's true. I wasn't trying to be funny. I'm serious. You know, like, the advantage that, you know, everyone has here today is social media. You know, like, I'm not trying to be like, I'm wild old and back in my day, but seriously, we had to go out, like, that's how we all met, was being at the same clubs, hanging out at the same the stores, record stores, video stores, you know, and like constantly bumping into each other, where I didn't have a choice. I had to be like, let me just introduce myself to this person. You know, like my friend Oscar that works for me, you know, like he literally, we kept bumping into each other the same place. I was like, all right, well, if we're at the same hip hop shows and hanging out the same record stores and same clothing stores, then I, there's a high percentage that I like this person, you know what I mean? So like, it's the same thing with social media. Like, if there's something you admire, like, there's nothing wrong with like a DM. Like, what's up, I'm working on this project. Do you wanna like collaborate together?
But I also
I give you a funny example. So, I like Twitter better than Instagram. I like words more, I like words. And you know, I feel like I get a bit more knowledge on Twitter. So anyway, I tweeted, I need a pair of boots with a demure toe, round toe, and a low heel. And a day later, my man that works at Levi's, he like connected me with this, one of the oldest cowboy boot companies in the world. And now we might do a collab. But now I know my situation is a little different, but it is kind of that, it's kind of that easy. You know, just put it out there. So maybe someone won't respond to you tweeting something, but a DM of the same ilk with a little bit of humor, you know what I mean? It goes far.
Now you're gonna add on?
I was just gonna say, put it out there in a way that's real though, because I get people, and
yeah, I was really looking for those boots.
Right, but you're different than, you're in a different situation. It's like, you have to also be realistic. You have to be realistic of where you're at. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's been collaborations that I wanted to do, and I had to be really honest with where I was at and if I could take it on, whether it was energetically, whether it was production-wise, whether it was whatever, you know, like, it was my dream to collaborate with Lauryn Hill, for example, and it took me 10 years to actually be in the place to do it properly, and for her to be in the place to do it properly, you know what I mean? But I, you know, it meant that much to me where it took that long, where it was like fostering a relationship, and then it was also working on my own, you know, production level where I could make the stuff that I wanted to make, or I was capable of supporting that, you know, and then I got other offers for collaborations during that time, dream offers that I would have died for, but energetically I couldn't have taken them on because I didn't have enough, I literally didn't have enough space in my energy to take on another thing. So I think it's really important to check in with yourself and be real about where you're at, who you can work with, and what you have to offer, and not just like shoot out DMs and be like, yo, can we collaborate? Because I get them all the time, and then when I actually look at the people's page, I'm like, this person isn't equipped to do that. Like, they're not at my level yet.
Oh, thank you. Gentlemen, one speaker. John, that sounds like a John Gray question.
I'm the wrong person to ask this because I got banned from all New York City high schools in 2004. But I do think I think schooling is a great space to build your network. But I think you should always be learning. You know, so like, yeah, this is self-education right here. You being here, taking the time. You know, you're not at home watching TV or doing whatever else you'd be doing. Like, you're soaking up games. So I think surrounding yourself with elders and even your own peer group, you know, they have a lot of knowledge. I heard someone say a lot of people try to network up, where it's like, yeah, the biggest resource is networking across. So like we're all contemporaries. So like rising with the people in your grade, the grade below you, mentoring, getting mentored, I think that's super important.
Awesome, how old are you?
15. Man, some people would say I have some level of success. When I was 15, I was just worried about comic books, girls, sports. Do that, man, just be a kid. That's gonna, if you really just, and I feel like that's what's happening now, not to sound like an old head, but like, kids are so, I'm not assuming you are so locked in on trying to get into their career path at such a young age. It's like, my career and everything I do and I've been able to work on, from the numerous projects I've worked on in the last 10 years plus, it's all came from me doing stuff I love. So it's like, I was in college and I was taking film and I was like, I'm not feeling this so much. I'm gonna go work retail and figure it out. And it's like, but I just kept on sticking to what I loved and what was interesting to me. So if what you love and interest is in that academia and in at Cornell or somewhere, go for that. There's no right answer. That's the thing, there's no right answer. And the path is inwards. I know, that's the only thing I know, the path is internal. It's not, you know, it's not out there, it's in you. And then you'll know. So that's why I always tell people to listen to Skepta's interview with Paul Rosenberg on Hot 97. Y'all should write this down and listen to it, because Skepta had a whole career and then he sold 56,000 records and his contract said, if you sell less than 60,000, we can drop you. He got dropped. Skepta's my friend, he was on his ass. And he had a revelation like, let me just come and really be 100% Skepta. And that changed his whole career. And that's what he talks about in the interview. They're like, oh, what about this one or that one? Did that? He's like, nope, what helped me is with becoming more and more me. Me, I keep, the more I become Tremaine and true to myself, the better the things I create are. So that's good, really tuning into who you are. That's what's gonna let you know, school or no school.
Let me just, one quick thing also, like the way you introduce yourself, I'm just in high school, like, fuck that. You know, there's a lot of power in your opinion, you know, and there's, you know, also take into consideration, we got another election coming up, you know what I mean? So those things that's where you're gonna be popular. The day that you turn 18, that's where you start evoking real power and you can start educating yourself right now, not just about this, because this is cool, but I can say no one up here is like finding the cure for cancer, you
You know what I mean? Like
exactly.
Like there's bigger. There's a bigger world. You know what I mean? So like, and it's just the fact that you're here tonight. That's pretty cool. For me, you're cool in my book.
That, it's good you bring it up. One quick thing. So, also, there's another interview you should watch. It's the Ashley Gates interviewing Kerry James Marshall, and it's on the New York Times. And the first question is, you know, the Ashley asks Kerry, "How important is art?" And then Kerry goes, "Kerry just his art sells for millions of dollars." He goes, "It's not that important." And that might seem counterintuitive because we're up here like we're important, but again. You know, this is just one sector of things you could do in the world. You know, going, there's people who devote their whole lives to helping people. Most of the stuff I do is self-serving, and once in a blue, and I'm trying to change that, I do some charity or something like that. The people that live their whole life like that, and those are the really, to me, really, really, really important people. I'm not saying I'm not important. So, like Angelo said, it's like, this is just one part of it. This may not be really the path for you, because this is just, a lot of it's just entertainment. It's like, do we need more clothes? Do we need more any of this? You know, we don't. You know, the planet might not be here in 100 years. Do we need a Denim Tears t-shirt that isn't recycled? You know, these are the questions that you can ask yourself that I never asked myself until now. I'm in my 30s, you're 15. You can make that your whole mantra. And that's a beautiful thing if you choose to take on that onus.
Thank you, Tremaine.
Nope.
Do you want to repeat that? Yeah, repeat that a little slower, a little louder, though.
How do you go about approaching manufacturing
deals, looking for investors, and making
the right moves without selling out your brand to a
bigger corporation? That's more like three questions in one. Let's start with like basically like how to get your clothes done.
Yeah. So how do you find? Well, that's when the community comes in. I mean, you could do research online, you can find, but like a brand that you really like and find out like where they get their t-shirts made. But it's really, again, the community, because you might not have access, but you might know someone that you don't even know that knows someone else that can help you get something made for a good price. I just stress like community research. I know I was looking for Bethy in particular. I wanted to work with a production house that was predominantly women, which was really hard to do. But I found them and they existed. And that was from research, but it was also from like, you know, asking a ton of my friends, sending emails, like, you know, just knowing what's going on out there. But yeah, I found this company called Everybody World, and they actually make a lot of sustainable clothing. But there are other smaller companies. I just would say, find your community and ask them.
Mel, do you want to answer the second part of that question, which was how do you go about finding investors?
I'm so pretty now, to be honest. Like, I've been self-funded and I'm 10 years in. And I finally got to the point where I was like, okay, if I really want to take my business to the next level, if I want to grow it, I have to raise money to do it. And I'm in the middle of research, because having an investor is sort of like getting married. You know, it's really finding like the perfect man. And it's hard. You know, some people want to take a large percentage of your business. Some people just think you're cool, so they invest in you because of that. Some people want a return. It's all about the bottom line. So you just need to first you need to figure out what you're about. You know, it's like, what's important to you? Like, what are you trying to build? Are you trying to build something up and then sell it after 5 years? Are you trying to have a brand for 50 years? You know, are you trying, like, what is it that you're about? And then really learn how to articulate that and then start putting it out there. You know, just start talking to people like, yeah, I'm looking for funding, and then see what comes back to you.
Yeah, and be industrious. Like, my dad, he told me the story, Spike Lee. So my dad, my mom used to own a video store. So people thought they had money, but we didn't. They were breaking even. And Spike Lee was making this movie, She's Gotta Have It, I believe, right, Dad? And he came by with the script, he heard of my dad, and he was looking for an investment. My dad didn't have money to invest in it. So Spike made that film off on credit cards, you know? So I think the key is be industrious. Jimi Hendrix couldn't afford a left-handed guitar, so he just played it upside down. Virgil Abloh went to the rugby store, bought all the rugbies on sale, and screen printed on them. Now he's an artistic director of Louis Vuitton. So really it's like, how bad do you want it? You know, how long you want to sleep on the couch? A lot of people talk about that. What are you willing to do? How much ramen are you willing to eat every night instead of, you know what I mean? Like what, or how bad do you want it? How bad do you really want it? Because we all live in the first world, so we're blessed off rip. We don't live in a third world country. We live in a first world. So it might take you 10 years, 5 years, but you can figure it out. You just gotta be industrious.
Cool. This gentleman?
Yeah. To go back to what you were saying about storytelling. So yeah. Like my favorite author is Octavia Butler. She was an Afrofuturist, yeah, like passed away. But for her anthology book, Seed to Harvest, she plotted out the entire story in reverse and then she wrote it. So I'm wondering, when you guys create your concepts, where do you start in the story? And then how do you build from that to create the
John, part of it? I feel like this is a John Gray question.
This is a good John Gray question. For me, I think I do the same. I reverse engineer. So I think about what I want to do, who I want to be around, and like I said, what art do we want to put into the world, and just kind of work backwards from that and to get to the right vibe.
Yeah, Mel, do you want to add on to that? Okay. Next question.
It's very important, but mentors are like, you gotta meet them halfway. So, yeah, it's very important. And the thing is, everyone keeps saying coming up, you don't know when you're coming up. It's like getting taller. I'm not like, oh, I'm gonna be 6'2 one day. One day you wake up, you're 6'2. So anyway, it's just like, Angelo and Shaniqua Jarvis. So I was very lucky, you know, I have my parents, my grandparents, cousins that were very strong. Intelligent, strong family, but I still isn't always enough. So I give it, there's so many people I could count out, but since they're here, Shaniqua Jarvis and Angelo, they've been friends slash mentors for years. And when I found out that I was moving to London, my old job, Marc Jacobs, they moved me to London in 2010. Angelo was like, I'm coming to your going away party. I had the back of Cafe Select. He's like, I'm gonna bring somebody special for you. And then he brought Shaniqua, and I hadn't seen Shaniqua in a long time. I met her through an ex-boyfriend who's a good friend of mine to this day. And he brought Shaniqua to Cafe Select, and he said, yo, Shaniqua lives in London. She's gonna make sure you're good. And from the day I touched ground, Shaniqua introduced me to so many amazing people. And I'm not mean people I can network with, just good people. And some of the people I end up doing business with, so many people are just my friends. And Angelo, every time he came to London, he'd be busy as hell doing stuff for Supreme. He always make time to come and link me and check in on me. So, you know, Angelo's a big, you know, he's just a little bit older than me, but he's definitely a big mentor. And has it changed? I think so, because now, because of social media, the kids and the OGs feel equal, right? Because before, it was like Wizard of Oz. You'd never see James W. or Sean Stussy, or Angelo, or Peter Saab, all these people. Now, everyone has access, so everyone's feeling like the kids ain't really seeing the mentor as mentors. They're like, they're just trying to chop heads. So I think if kids just chilled out a bit and met the OGs halfway, they'd have more mentors. And I think that's how it's changed. But on the other side, a lot of the OGs are embittered and salty because they see people getting rich or whatever, doing stuff that they did or invented, and they can't handle it. And that's what makes you an old head. So like the OGs gotta be OGs, not old heads. And the kids need to recognize and meet them halfway and learn and realize they're not, you're equal as far as like the rights and respect you deserve, but you're not equal in your accomplishments, what you've done. But yeah, I gotta thank Angela and Shanika so much. Like, you know, I started off this thing talking about how much my mom meant to me and stuff like that, but really Angela and Shanika and a couple other people, they really, 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 really enhanced and changed my life career-wise and just as a human being. So, thank you.
I'm gonna add on to that. Thank you, Jermaine. You know I love you, I keep saying that, I do love you. I didn't have any mentors, right? And it was always a struggle because what Jermaine is talking about, unfortunately, you know, our predecessors that helped create this kind of streetwear world weren't so, not so much about success, but they weren't willing to hand it over or to say, yo, here's the recipe. You know, so for me, that instead of, it worked the opposite way. Instead of saying like, yo, fuck this next generation, it's like, yo, real empowerment is empowering others. Because if I could be part of anyone's narrative here on your path to success, that's real wealth. And that's legacy. Because for me, it's all about legacy. That's the whole point of doing this. You know, like 1000% honest, like I don't make a dime off any of this stuff. You know what I'm saying? So like all this is just a selfless act of like just trying to give it away. Just trying to give it away. Because if I could bump into one of y'all a year from now, 2 years from now, 2 years from now, 5 years from now, and like, yo, I'm the head A&R at this label. I'm the art director for this clothing brand. You know, all because of that talk or because of social studies, you know, like, and I've been getting DMs from, you know, the Miami Art Basel that we did from kids that are like on their paths. You know, they just redirected from their experience at social studies. And I'm like, you know what? That's all the wealth. That's all the money. That's all I need. You know, just to hear that. You know, so on that note, I want to say thank you to Beth, Tremaine, Mel, John for, you know, participating, getting a little choked up. But, and all y'all for showing up, because without y'all, honestly, I wouldn't be here. You know what I mean? Like, straight up, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for y'all. So thank you for showing up. Thank you for listening. And that's it, man.
Thank you, Angela.
Thank you, Angela.
Like Nike and Timberland to sponsor your event for something that you have a vision for.
And look like this.
And look like that.
And that's education-based.
And that's education-based, because for companies like that, it's about the bottom dollar. Yeah. So for him to pull this off is really special, and we're all very thankful for you.
Cool. If y'all want to ask questions, feel free to come up here. Peace, y'all. Love y'all.